you were better than the first crowd. No, they were average today, but you guys are like on it. So let's stand on up and get into our worship today. God, we thank you so much for the time and opportunity to just come before your feet. Father, we pray that your throne will be lifted up today. God, we pray that everything that we do points to who you are. God, speak to us, grow us, change us, renew us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus. Aren't you glad he made a way for us? Amen. Hey, I'm Ron Pierce. I serve as a chaplain in the Air National Guard at Little Rock Air Force Base. I know I'm a new face. I've been coming here for a while, and I'm really looking forward to getting to know all of you. I know some of you, and looking forward to getting to know the rest. But it's great to be here this morning with the Renew family and to be a part of what's going on here. And I'm excited about some of the things that are coming up and just being involved in ministry with you. Well, as we come to this portion of our service, if you're visiting here, we want you to feel welcome as we celebrate communion together corporately. It's volunteer, it's not required, but we invite you to celebrate with us. And as we celebrate, I just wanted to kind of bring our focus to this special time in the worship service as we give it to the Lord. Just the idea that we're coming before Him and remembering what He did for us as we take the bread and the cup. You know, it says in 1 Corinthians 11 that when we do this, we do it to remember Him. And so one question I'd like for you to ask as you do this is, why am I coming to the table? And it's so that we can remember Him and what He did for us and the sacrifice that He made for us. That passage also says that when we do this, we proclaim His death until He comes. We're so thankful for what He did for us and how it paved the way for our future glory and all that we will have in Christ when that time comes. It's an amazing thing. It's a wonderful thing. The other question, though, is who will you dine with at the table? You might be with your spouse today. You might be with your family or a couple of families. Maybe the people you're sitting with or some friends. But I also want to remind us all that no matter who you celebrate with in this room, you're also always going to have at least a table of two, because the Lord Jesus Christ is there with us. He died for us and He's coming again, but in between all of that, He is right here with us in our midst, not only when we celebrate communion, but as we walk out of here and as we live our lives, Christ is with us each and every moment, giving us the strength we need and pouring love into our hearts. So, as we celebrate, we have stations around the room. We have a gluten-free station up here in the middle front. I'm going to lead us in the prayer, and then you celebrate as you feel led. Lord, we just thank You for this day that You have made. We thank You for this body of Christ that has come together to worship You. We just ask for Your blessings during this special time as we celebrate communion. Lord, I just pray for a blessing on all of us, Lord, as we go out into the world this day and shine a light into the world that desperately needs it. Lord, we lift this up to You, and we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Father, here we are in this moment in your presence. Thank you, Father, for not being a God that's far off, but who's with us now, moving in and through us. And I pray that you will help us to see the things that we need to see today. That we will be moved and transformed because of who you are and what you have in mind for us in this church. So help us to experience your joy in all things. This worship is all about you. Let it not end just because we stop singing, but let it be worship as we open these pages of Scripture to see what you have in mind for us. It is in the name of Jesus that we pray. You can have a seat. So I would guess a few of you probably know that song. That was a hit song in 1965. How many of you were not born yet? All right, me too. So, here's the thing though. It probably would win the record for the number one hit with the oldest lyrics. And let me explain. Here's basically what it says. For everything, there's a season, a time to every purpose under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to reap that which is planted, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to break down, a time to build up, a time to weep, a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get, a time to lose, a time to keep, a time to cast away. A time to rend, a time to sow. A time to keep silence, a time to speak. A time to love, a time to hate, a time of war, and a time of peace. 14 pairs, extensive but not exhaustive. All kinds of beginnings and ends that many of us identify with in various ways. And what's interesting about this song, and the reason why it probably holds the record for the oldest lyrics, is because it comes right out of Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. Thousands of years, we see these words timeless for us that teach us something we need to know, that help us to understand life. Of course, everything in the song is right out of Scripture except the last line, a plea for peace. It's not too late. Turn, turn, turn. Certainly in our own lives, we understand that there's a time and a place for all things and that there are seasons. We understand seasons. Of course, that's what this song is about. There's seasons of life and we experience seasons in everything. Now, what's interesting for myself, I really became acutely aware of this a couple of years ago. I was actually in the shower thinking about my day, and I realized that I had been lying to our church staff for a couple of years. Not on purpose, but I had been totally doing that. And I'm thinking about how busy life was a couple of years ago in the ministry at Renew Community Church and all the things that we had to do. And I thought to myself, you know, I tell our staff all the time, it's just a season. That's why it's so busy. It's just a season. Eventually it will slow down. It's just a season. And I realized that day in the shower, it wasn't a season. That's just life. It's just that busy. And so I kind of moped into the staff meeting that day and I said, look, I got to repent to all of you. I've been telling you for years now as we got Renew up and running and as it's been growing and doing all these things that as busy as we are, I've been telling you constantly, it's just a season. But I don't think it's a season. I think this is just our lives here. And everybody laughed at me. And I think it was Natalie who says, are you really just now figuring that out? And I went, I think so. And they all said, we know it's just a season. I'm glad you're finally figuring it out. This is just how life goes. But we do have seasons of life. Even when it all feels the same and there's busyness beyond compare, there are still seasons. Seasons are very real. Now, we've discussed seasons before around here at Renew, although it's been years since we really did it, which is really a shame. We really should talk about it more often. Probably we should talk about it in the natural cycle of church. There really are three main cycles that you see in the church world. You have Christmas to Easter. You have Easter to basically through summer. And then you have school start to Christmas again. Those are sort of the three normal cycles. And we experience it here in a sense of seasons. They're very different cycles or the life in of a church, and all churches deal with that kind of stuff, but we probably should talk about it more often and talk about those kinds of things that will help us understand what's really going on. But as we go into summer and as we begin a huge building project, which is about to launch, it makes sense for us to step back and say, okay, where have we been? And where are we going? And this is important for us because we need to remain unified in the vision that God's given us. And it's in times of seasons that shift back and forth that sometimes we feel a little off balance and we run the risk of not being unified. And that's what the devil loves. The devil loves to cause division and loves people to have different visions and missions and ideas of where we're going, and we mustn't. We must stay unified and say, this is where God is taking us and what he wants to do with us. And so today will be a little different probably than my normal sermon. I want to work through some things with you because I want to set some very clear expectations for you. I want to set clear expectations so you're not off balance, so you know what's coming, and we can together pursue the Lord because this is what he's calling us to. And we can do it, but we want to make sure that we have a clear vision of where we're headed. And so I want to lay it out for you. And I really just want to go through it one piece at a time. And of course, I'm not going to be able to tell you all the things that we already do. But I want to lay out some groundwork for you so you know what's coming. But here's the thing. You have no reason to be scared. If I created a little anxiety in you just now, it's okay. Everybody take a deep breath. Are you ready on three? One, two, three. It's okay. There's nothing to be scared of. It's exciting. It's exciting. Okay? So here we go. So whether this is your first day or you've been here since the first day, this is important. But here's the big idea. In everything, there's a season. In every area of our lives, everything, there is indeed seasons. We see it in the Bible, of course, and it lays it out for us, which is the only reason why this even makes sense to us. But you see it even in the creation week in Genesis chapter 1. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 14, God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons, and for the days and for the years." That God, from the very, very, very beginning, created the idea of seasons. And I love that. And it helps us to understand seasons in our own lives as well. But we don't just stop there. The moon was made for our seasons. Psalm 104 and 19 says he made the moon to mark the seasons. The sun knows its time for setting. Or how about seasons are a gift from God? Acts 14, 17. Although I'll stop there and say, I don't know about you if you've ever been to like Simi Valley, California. There's one season there and I like it. But I also like, you know, colorful leaves that fall until you have to rake them. So, but Acts 14, 17, yet he did not leave himself without witness, for he did good by giving you rains from heaven and fruitful seasons. By the way, this is our theme this year here at Renew. The theme for 2017 is to bear fruit. And so part of this is not just from us just going, we're going to make sure that we bear fruit. No, it is what God does in us individually and us collectively in the city. It is to be fruitful, to do the things he's called us to, satisfying your hearts with food and gladness. Now, let me just say too, what would happen if the 1,000 people or so that call Renew home really allowed this to be true, that we would allow our hearts to be satisfied with spiritual food and his goodness? Instead of pursuing all the things that the world tells us will satisfy us, what if we really said, I'm going to let God satisfy my deepest needs? Not stuff that will burn up or rust and fall apart, but to let the Lord satisfy us and bear fruit that is eternal fruit. It would be amazing, I think. Something that we should talk about more. There are also seasons of development. You know, we have this built into us. At one time, everyone here was fearfully and wonderfully made. knit together in your mother's womb. That was a season. You were born and you were an infant and dependent and on someone to take care of you. That was a season. You grew to be a child. You began to learn how to feed yourself and take care of things. That was a season. You grow to be a teenager. That's a weird season. It's a dark, crazy, confusing season of life. And then we move on and we become adults. There's a season, and parents and grandparents and all that. That's beautiful. God designed it this way, designed it from creation, from Genesis 1 all the way through, not just for sun, moon, and stars, but for us too, that we have seasons of development. By the way, it's not just physical seasons. I think there's spiritual seasons as well that are very similar. If you think about it, in this room, a room this size with this many people, for sure there are people that are pre-born spiritually. You're not quite there yet. You haven't said, I'm all in with Jesus. But thinking about it, or at least you're here and you're curious, but pre-born, not quite there. But there's also infants, people that are brand new believers, but also children that have learned how to feed themselves a little spiritually. And you're praying on your own and studying your Bible and growing and doing some of that spiritual formation stuff that helps you mature and develop. And there are people who are adults in this who have been at it a long time. By the way, number of years I don't think matters as much as just spiritual maturity in general of growing and developing. And there are parents in this room, which means they're discipling the next generation of Christians, and even grandparents in the room that are discipling people who are discipling people. So even in that case, spiritually, we have seasons that we work through and that develop and change and transition over the years as we seek after the Lord. But again, there's seasons and everything. Think about the way that we do weddings. I've done lots of them. And in the weddings, we acknowledge seasons of life in joy or in sorrow, in sickness or in health. These are seasons of life. And we identify and we understand these things. Seasons in careers, success, failure. Seasons in relationships, friendships, families, as we raise our children or grandchildren or someone else's children. How we go through life. In fact, I even hear, not sure, but I hear that there's something called a razorback season. I don't know. Anybody ever heard of that? No? Okay, good. Me neither. So in life, there are seasons. I've been through many. In all these areas, all these things that we've talked about, I've been through all kinds of seasons, ups and downs, highs and lows of life. And my guess is you have too. In fact, I won't even guess. I know for a fact the one thing that we all have in common is that we've gone through ups and downs of life, seasons of plenty and want, of joy and sorrow, of light and darkness, seasons of life. In fact, there are seasons that we could identify with probably on the calendar type of seasons, like there's winter. Winter often feels like you're just simply surviving. It feels like death, although even in the wintertime, the trees aren't dead, but they look it. But it feels like that sometimes. Everything around looks cold and miserable and dark and death. And some of you in this room are there right now. But then there's springtime. Springtime is exciting. What seemed dead is now new. Life emerges. Things begin to grow. And some of you are there right now. There's summertime where everything's joyful. Lots of play, lots of joy. Every moment, it's an exciting moment of new discovery. And some of you are there right now, and there's fall where we reap a harvest of the work that has been done, and we prepare for winter. And some of you are there right now. Seasons of life. And here's the thing. Churches go through that too. Churches have seasons that we deal with. Again, of course, I believe this is something that God intended as he creates seasons from the very beginning. We identify with different times. Life would be boring if it were just the same all the time. Would you agree? But we go through seasons and change and transition in our own lives. And the church is the same. And every church leader must ask, what season are we in? We can't be afraid of it. We have to be able to ask those questions because in order to lead well and be able to lead us through whatever the season, we have to know what the season is. And we have to know what God is calling us to and where he wants us to go. And so Bill Hybels, love him or hate him, it doesn't matter. That's his face. If you have no idea what I'm talking about, it doesn't matter. But he wrote this great book called Axiom. If you want a quick read, go pick it up. It's old. In fact, people use this in the business world and church world and all that stuff. It's a little itty-bitty thing. Probably if you're a fast reader, could read it in an hour, maybe two. But it's a fast read. But Bill says that there are five seasons of life. Now, one of these days, I'm sure I'll get a chance to meet Bill, and I will tell Bill, I loved your book, Axiom, but why five seasons, bro? It would have been easier to four, because we all understand four, but to you, I will say, in Arkansas, we know what five seasons looks like. Season one, mosquito season in Arkansas. Season two is spontaneous combustion. That's season two. Season three is mosquito season again. Season four is leaf burning season, and season five is French toast season. Now, you may not be sure what I'm talking about. I think you probably got the other ones. Mosquito season, everybody knows what that is, right? Although I'm not sure that actually ever goes away, but supposedly, mosquito, you know, spontaneous combustion, it's 187 degrees. We just go like that. Mosquito season again, leaf burning. French toast is the weather forecaster sometimes says this really dirty four-letter word. It starts with an S. Snow. And what happens to people in the South is they want to make French toast. I don't understand, but it's true. All you got to do is hear the weatherman go, it could be a dusting of snow. And instantly, there are no bread or eggs or milk anywhere in town. It's like everybody says, it's going to snow, let's make French toast. Now, I'm from the North, and so we just actually drive in that stuff. I mean, that's just how it goes. Oh, it's going to snow. Great, I have tires on my car that have knobs on them. I'll be fine. But down here, French toast, baby. So there's a French toast season. That's at least what I've... So we understand five seasons. Hopefully you get that as well. But Bill, then, his seasons are a little different than my five seasons. And his first one is malaise. Now, malaise is not really a word that we probably use very often. But malaise basically is, it's dreaded. It's somber. It's death. It's stale. It's stuck. There's no buzz anywhere. And if you fail to change it, it will become the permanent reality. But he says there are five stages in the life of the church. Not all of them will go through malaise, but some of them are in malaise. And I'm guessing you've probably experienced that before, where the church was stuck, stale, nothing. There's also a reinvention stage for churches where you put everything under the microscope. You're asking the question, what's not working, and let's change it. By the way, that's a good principle, although churches sometimes have a hard time with that, which often leads to malaise. Churches need to be able to say, if this isn't working, let's stop and let's try it again, and let's do something different. I will tell you for myself personally, I'm not afraid to fail. I am, but here's the thing, if we're going to fail, let's fail fast and then recover faster and change the plan. That's one of the beauties of a church plant, and probably if you've been here any length of time, you've found that we don't just keep doing the same thing over and over because it's what we've always done. We're okay to change stuff because that makes things better sometimes. But if you don't, then you change it again. And that's how that goes. But reinvention is everything goes under microscope. You ask the question, what needs a facelift? What needs an overhaul? What needs a funeral? And let's change the things that need to be changed and prune stuff for future growth. Bill's third category is growth. Everything is rosy. Everything is exciting. Attendance is up. Giving is up. Everything looks bright. Consolidation usually follows a season of growth. And you're taking care of what came when you were growing. And you're doing what you can to help support that growth. And then the last season is transition, which means big things have changed. Some good, some bad. And you know that. Change is difficult on humans, but not all change is bad, right? Some change is good. And so change can be good. Change can be challenging, but change can make us feel off balance. And we don't know what's going around us. So the question is, where is Renew right now? Now, always, I have told you, I think we're in multiple seasons at any one time. I don't think it's just one or the other. I think it's not an either or, but a both and. And so I think we're living in several of those. But I will tell you, I do not at all think it's malaise. I don't think we're somber, stuck, or stale. I think we are alive and healthy and bearing fruit, which again is our theme for 2017. And I can prove it to you by the fact that we planted a church in Bryant, Arkansas this year out of this church. And that's amazing. That shows life and strength and growth. And we're in the process of doing it in Valonia. And by the beginning of the school year, we will have a presence on the campus at BNBB at ASU BB. That's exciting. Thank you. We are not stale or stuck. We had 13 visiting families 2 weeks ago. That's amazing to me. Things are moving. People are counting in. More volunteers are jumping in. And we're on track to have 50 or 60 or 70 baptisms this year. And that's exciting to me. We had 6 last week, 4 out of our youth group. That's beautiful and amazing. But here's the thing. If you feel malaise, if you feel like you are stuck here, or stale or somber, you need to come talk to me. Just come talk to me. And we'll work on it. We'll come up with a plan for how to help get out of that. Because even though Renew is not in a season of malaise, and I hope we never are, that is our prayer always. But if you were to get there, you get out of it as fast as possible. But I don't think we'll ever get there. But if you are there and you're stale and stuck and confused and not sure what's going on, you need to come talk to me because it's fixable and we can work on it together and I will work on it with you. All right, so not malaise, but reinvention and consolidation. Now, I put those two together because I think they go together. Although I like the fact that Bill made them separate things, I think they are intended to go together because as we put things under the microscope, and as we look at our ministries and the way that we do everything around here, asking, are we doing it to the best of our ability to reach people for Christ? Because ultimately, that's what we're trying to do. Ultimately, at the end of the day, here it is. We want to storm the gates of hell because it cannot withstand the pressure of the church and rescue people who are perishing for eternity, bring them to Christ. That's my mission, and I hope that's why you're here. And so, as we do that, we look at the ways that we do things and say, are we doing that? Are we accomplishing that task? Because there's so much more than just play in church. We want to go with this mission. And so we look at the things that we do, and we ask, are we accomplishing what God's called us to? And then, as we look at it, we prune the things that need to be pruned, so that you bear more fruit. Pruning is not super comfortable sometimes. And sometimes pruning happens naturally. But we want to prune things because as you prune a tree back, although it looks like you're killing it, it grows and it bears more fruit than it would have before. And it's important that we do that and we look at this. And by the way, this is a biblical thing. You look at something like John chapter 15. In John chapter 15, we see in verses 2 through 6, both of these pictures. So let me just read it to you. John 15, 2 through 6. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you're clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. In that one verse, and I could go on a couple more verses, you can read it on your own, but in that section of scripture, we see both reinvention and consolidation. The reinvention is the pruning, that we go in and we prune things so that it can bear more fruit and accomplish what it is that God wants to do, but it's also consolidation because we have to abide in Christ. If we fail to abide in Christ, if we fail to come in that close and settled union with Christ, we can accomplish nothing. You can build a big crowd without abiding in Christ, but you're not going anywhere. We want to abide in Christ, which is how we support the things that God is doing as we consolidate and come together. And so I want to go through a few things for you to see what to expect the rest of 2017. These are the things that you're going to see as we're going into summertime and as we go into the fall. As we move from one season to the next, these are some of the things that I want you to see that will help us to be more efficient at what God has called us to and to support the growth that we've seen and will see. The first one is I want to introduce you to some new shepherds that we are letting you know about today. Now, we have always had shepherds here. And in fact, when we first planted Renew, we asked shepherds or elders of other churches to help shepherd us because we think it's a biblical principle and it's good. Now, I've always been one. We've had some that have moved and moved on, but we wanted today to introduce you to these three. And so out of these three couples that we've been working with for months and months and months, studying together and praying together and fasting and working through what it is that God calls us to, but God has called us to at least these three families. You have Jerry Chisholm and his wife Kelly, Dean Campbell and his wife Deanna, and Dave Mills and his wife Laurel. Now, this is a biblical thing, and last year we did a whole series on biblical leadership, understanding that God calls us to have shepherds or overseers or elders that work within the church. And if you like that analogy of shepherding, they are protecting the flock. That is the big picture. Shepherds in the Bible, no matter what church background you came from, if they had their elders that were trying to pick the colors of the chairs, they're not doing a biblical job. The reality is that biblical elders do not worry about the color of the chairs. They worry about the sheep. They worry about whether people are on the right track or if they're about to fall off the cliff, and they come together. And so I am one of these with this these guys in coming together to do what is here in Acts 14, 23, when they had appointed elders or shepherds for them in every church with prayer and fasting. They committed them to the Lord in whom they had believed. And so today, we tell you, we are committing them to the Lord to do this work that is important. And it's not the end. We will continue. And part of my job here is to do what Paul was doing in those days in training up leaders and helping to develop them so that they can shepherd the church that the Lord has planted in the city and in Bryant and Valonia and Beebe and anywhere else we go. This is a beautiful, healthy picture of what shepherding should be. So the second thing that we're going to do is we're going to have more opportunity for you to see a teaching team develop here at Renew. Now, I need to develop more of these, and they need the practice, but here's the idea in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2. It says, "And what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." Part of what you're going to experience, and you've already experienced it some, is you're going to hear other voices preaching and teaching at times here. Now, for the time being at least, you'll hear me mostly, but I want you to hear something very, very clear. I'm not going anywhere. I have no intention of leaving. And you need to be settled in that. Because what I'm about to say, I don't want you to draw incorrect conclusions. So here's what this is. I want to have other people trained where they can preach and teach for you, but part of that is because as we plant churches, we need pastors to be able to go and be able to preach and teach. Makes sense, right? It's hard to just do that in a classroom environment. It's really important you train them and then let them do it and let them preach in front of a congregation, because that's how you learn and that's how you develop and how you are mentored, is by doing it. And so as we prepare for the next layer of leaders to go out and plant 100 churches, as we're training people to go and lead studies and teach in various ways, I need to be able to train them and give them opportunity to speak and get feedback from you. You will learn something different and good. It will be healthy for you to hear other voices. But here's the other side of that. God has called me to be able to coach and mentor and train other church leaders that aren't a part of the Renew thing. And I have guys that I coach in Nebraska and Oklahoma and Texas and all over the place. Part of the behind-the-scenes ministry you never see. It doesn't benefit Renew in any way, but it does benefit the kingdom, because you know what's happening? Hundreds and hundreds of people are coming to Christ in these other cities. And these young preachers are learning how to do it better and being able to mentor and train their own leaders. And thousands of people are going to eventually come to Christ, and you're going to meet people in heaven that you didn't even know existed. I need to be able to get away and do it. I talk to these guys on the phone. I prep them. I teach them. I pick on them. I beat them up. I encourage them. But sometimes I need to go sit in their assembly in the back and watch, because you learn something different when you do that. So here's the thing. I love you so much, but I need you to share me a little bit. And that may sound weird, but I say it because over the years, as I've stepped away and had someone else preach, and I've gone to either go coach somebody else or just take a weekend off, because guess what? I could use that every now and then. Have you seen how tightly wound I am? I need a week off sometimes, because I want to pour out of overflow, and there are times I need to step back and go, I need to go spend about 40 hours just with Jesus and me, just to get back where I need to be so I can overflow. But often throughout those times, I've had people come up to me and go, man, I really don't like it when you're not here. I really don't like to listen to other people preach. And I understand you love me, but it's healthy for you to hear other voices. And so here's what I want us to work on. I want to get us to a point where I can tell you I'm not going to be here next weekend. By the way, I am going to be here next weekend. But I want to be able to say I'm not going to be here next weekend because Ryan's preaching or somebody else is preaching. And I would like to see the attendance grow, not contract. Because if people are being led by the Holy Spirit, they can teach you other things just like I can. And in fact, you might learn some things that you from them that you won't learn from me because of different life experiences. It's important for the growth of this church and the kingdom that we do that. And so, again, I want to reaffirm for you one last time, I don't have any plans to go anywhere. Now, if God were to say to me, you got to get up and go plant something else, guess what? Yeah. I would have to obey. But I have not heard that from him. And in fact, I've told him, I really would prefer not to plant another church. This was really hard. But here's the thing. I love it here, and I love you. And I want to grow old with you. But I also want to storm the gates of hell. I want to reach thousands and thousands and thousands. Not because I need them to say it at my funeral, but because this is who God has created me to be, but I cannot do it alone, nor do I want to. But we are called to a very important mission. And along the way, we can enjoy life together and love one another and build relationships, but we also got to storm the gates of hell and rescue those who are perishing. To be whatever we have to be outside of sin so that we may reach a few. But I hope the few is tens of thousands of people. And that's not some ego trip. I want to have the biggest church in blah, blah, blah. Nope. I want to see people be fully and completely transformed and it leave a legacy of faith behind for generations to come. For their children and their great-grandchildren and their great-great-great-grandchildren to be in heaven. I want to see my children and my grandchildren and my great-great-great-grandchildren in heaven, whom will never even know my name, but to leave a legacy of faith, and I want that for you too. So don't worry, but I do need to continue to train up the next generation of leaders, and it is part of the season of life that we're in. Most likely, you'll hear my voice still most of the time, and it's not going to change overnight, but it is one of the things that we're going to continue to grow and develop, because here's the last thing I want to say. This is not about me. This is not my church. This is God's church. He is the head. And we are at his bidding, and we want to do what he calls us to. The next thing that we're called to this year is to go, continually push to get outside this building. You know, we're in a very delicate stage of ministry right now. We've celebrated our 5-year anniversary. We'll celebrate our 6th year this summer. And years 5 to 7 are some of the most dangerous years of ministry. The first year, of course, is the most delicate, but years 5 to 7 are the next most delicate, and it's because at year 5, churches tend to become inward-focused, and they want to do everything for themselves, and they forget to raid the gates of hell. And 5 to 7 is where that happens, generally speaking. Part of why I'm speaking to you the way that I am today is to tell you we must not fall away from this vision that God has called us to. Which is, this building is just a building. The building we build next door will still just be a building. We are the church. And when we leave these doors, we are called to a mission to go and to rescue those who are perishing. And so we will continue to do it. And you're going to hear me talk about a lot over the next year because we're halfway through that delicate 5 to 7 year thing. But we continue to push. And if we can continue to make sure that DNA is set, we are bound to continue with what God has called us to. But that means we need to have an incarnational kind of ministry. John 14:12, truly I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do. And greater works than these will he do because I'm going to the Father. Now, that doesn't mean we can do miracles better than Jesus. But what would happen if the millions and millions of people that are really sold out believers for Christ, what if they really said, we are going to do what Jesus did? It would change the world. What if just 1,000 people or so that call Renew home were to say, we are going to live a life like Christ and do what Jesus did? It would change everything. The city would be transformed. Would. You know it's true. And so we have an incarnational ministry. Always have, always will. A missional ministry. Luke 19:10, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. Or John 20:21, Jesus said to them again, peace be with you as the Father sent me, so I'm sending you, Renew. I'm sending you. This is who we're called to be. Please don't despise serving and reaching. We need to, yes, reach inside, but also outside and be innovative and reach people where they are, meet them where they are, and love them too much to let them stay lost, but to draw them in to see the beauty of a relationship with Christ, especially one within community like this. Ephesians 2:10, though, we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works. Or Galatians 5:13, through love, serve one another. Or Luke 14:23, the master said to the servant, go out into the highways and the hedges and compel people to come in, that my house may be filled. This year, I want us to create a more clear path for spiritual growth and maturity. It comes out of the Great Commission, Matthew 28:19-20. Go, step one, make disciples, followers of Jesus, baptize those disciples, and then teach them to obey everything Jesus taught. That's a lifelong adventure. I'm still obeying, still learning to obey. It is a call to all of us. And part of what we want to do here at Renew is be able to give you a clear pathway for how to grow. Now, I know this is hard to read because it's large, but I'm going to put this in your hands soon. But this is basically when people come up to me and go, hey, I love Renew. I want to get involved. We're going to say, great, here's your roadmap, okay? And so basically at the top, there's the missional, incarnational. I just talked about those things. Attractional, as people come in, we make a connection with people. And then I contact them. It's off in the 45 degree. I contact them, call our guests when they fill out guest cards, and then hopefully move them into this area of being of connecting, which means to come on a consistent basis and continue to get involved in whatever has to go on. Like today, we'll take up chairs. Guess what? Today, if this is your first day here, we invite you to ministry. Your first day by simply stacking chairs. It is a ministry. It is. And so we invite you into those kinds of things. Come to a connections class with me, and let me tell you the story of Renew. And then after you say, okay, I'm in, if you haven't been baptized, hopefully you'll go, okay, I'm ready for that, and that great commissional step as we get to that point. And so we'll do it, and then we'll let the shepherds have an opportunity to talk to you, and they'll develop a spiritual growth plan for you. This is important, because here's the deal. Not everyone in here is in the same season of your spiritual development. If you've been a Christian, and you're a mature believer, and you've been at it for 40 years, you don't need the same roadmap that someone has that we baptized last weekend, right? And so part of what we're going to ask our shepherds to do is to meet people and talk to them about where they are, and then give them a plan and a tool for how they can continue to grow to the next level. And then you invite it in down at the bottom. It's find a way to serve, get involved in people's lives. Part of that, remember when I talked about malaise, if you feel stuck or if you're sitting here even today and you feel lonely, I can solve it for you today. Get involved in a group and do life with people. It will solve it. It will. And so we do group life, and that's the stuff at the bottom. And then as you continue on, where if you're willing and you want to, we train you how to be leaders. Some of you will train how to be preachers, church planters, or lead ministries if you want to, if that's where you feel like God's calling you. But we want to continue to work better at helping to provide a roadmap for you to grow. We also want to, this year, improve volunteer base, which means we're going to continue to do those volunteer luncheons. Please come to those. I would love to see every Renew person there. We're going to continue to expand the building. Now, this is probably our biggest transition this year. By the way, this construction plan begins this week. We're going to begin to construct and build this facility. Thank you for the two of you that are excited about that. I appreciate that. Here's what I want to say about it. We've talked about it. Here's what I want to say. Please don't be afraid. I think anytime you have a change, it creates a little fear. So let me put some of your minds at ease. Our DNA does not change because we create a bigger space. We will still have concrete floors. Why? Because we are a mission station, not a museum. We are not going to go out and buy a steeple. Please quit asking me if we're going to have a steeple. Our steeple is the Cabot Water Tower right behind us. Paid for. It's all done. We are not going to have stained glass. There are just too many hungry people in the city to do that stuff. Now, I'm not picking on other churches. If they want to have steeples and stained glass, whatever. But for us, we are a mission station, not a museum. That will not change when we go next door. What next door does for us is it expands the ability for us to grow as God is going to lead and develop things, but also creates opportunity as we have more classrooms to do things like after-school programs. And I told you here not too long ago, the Boys and Girls Club that we were working toward, they told us we're not offering any more charters, so you got to do it on your own. So we're working toward figuring out how to do that on our own without the Boys and Girls Club thing. We couldn't do it here if we tried. We have to be in the next building. It will also allow us to have classrooms that we can train pastors and leaders of other churches that will come here and we'll train them how to go out into their own cities and do some of the things that we do here. It will also allow us to have career re-education and those kinds of things. And maybe, who knows, even a Christian school. We'll see what God has in mind. But it will also open up the door for our medical clinic and our dental clinic and counseling clinic so we can meet people in the middle of their brokenness and lead them to Jesus. That's why. Or an automotive clinic. But by the way, the automotive thing started yesterday and we got to serve people. Now, this next one is something I've been dreaming about for a long time that you're going to see happen in 2017, which is a special needs ministry that we're about to launch. Ron, who walked us through communion today, came to me, and we've been talking about it. He's been a part of Renew for several months now, and he has a special needs daughter, and as we talked through what needs to be done in this city, he is going to help us create a special needs ministry to reach out to people in the city that oftentimes get left behind or forgotten. And we're going to reach out to them, and we're going to love on them and serve those families. And that's a beautiful thing, I think. And so, now, I want you also to know that this was one of the first sort of dreams that I had for Renew. In fact, before Renew began, before I knew any of your faces, Jennifer and I prayed and prayed and fasted and asked God, what do you want to do in this city? What do you want your church to look like? And the things that we do now are those things. And I wrote about 30 pages of stuff. And amazingly, we've done almost all of it, except for the special needs ministry. But on page 8 in that original thing that I wrote up in 2010, before Renew launched, I wrote, special education, we have already begun working in one of the schools in Cabot to help with special education programs. You know what it was in the beginning? We knew this was part of what we're called to, and went to the special ed teachers, and I went, hey, could I come in and read to the kids or play music? And the schools invited me in, and I would sit and play music and sing to the children. And I told them, all I know are Jesus songs. And they went, go for it. And I led worship to rooms full of special needs kids. That was the beginning of really special needs ministry. But along the way, I've prayed, God, bring the people here that need to take this where it needs to go. And that's happened. And God has brought Ron and his family to help us with this. And that's what. And so we don't know exactly what that will look like, but we have a really good idea of where it will start. Who knows what it'll look like 5 years from now, but one of the things I want to do is create something that we can share with churches all around the country that will work where they can reach the least of these, because that's part of the picture of a healthy biblical church. But we'll launch that off in October once we get into the new building, and if you want to be a part of that, I would encourage you to talk to Ron about it today even. The last thing is better communication. I want us to be able to communicate better, especially as we grow. This is really, really important that we have better communication. Because if we were to double in size, the way that we communicate now may be difficult. There was a time, some of you remember, that I would actually, before a big event or a holiday, I'd text everybody one at a time. It literally now would take me 3 or 4 days all day long to do it because I've done it. And it's almost impossible for me to do it now. I would love to do it, but I just can't. And so we want to continue to help with good communication. Here are things you can do today. Maybe take a picture of the slide, or you can do this right now. If you will open up your phone, you have freedom to do it. Text, the number would be 292929 with the word renew me, just one word in it, and you'll get a response back, and that will log in, and then when we have things come up, we can let you know. And then also, we have a church app. If you go out there and look up My Church by Alexio, and you can get to all kinds of things. You can give online, you can watch sermons and all kinds of things, and we want to improve that for you. All right, couple last things. I want to go back to the seasons for a moment. Growth. Are we growing? Are we in a season of growth? Well, God continues to add to the church daily those who are being saved. That's Acts 2:47. That is really not my job, although he's called me to be a part of it as well as you, but we need lots of help. And so as we expand into the building, we're going to add 6 more classrooms. Guess what that means? We need help. Every church needs help with their kids' ministry. We need help now, and we'll need help then. In order to teach hundreds of children every week, we need people to step up, even if it's once a month, and love on the kids. You don't have to teach. You could just be a bouncer. You know, I mean, we have different jobs in that, but we need men and women to help with that. I also want to put you in a place where you can think about the growth is a good thing. I know it's common sometimes to walk into a building and go, I don't know any of these faces. Guess what? That's okay. You can solve it instantly. Here's how you should solve it when you walk into a room and there's all these new faces. Hi, my name is, insert your name here. That's how it works. It's amazing and miraculous. Or invite someone to come sit next to you or share communion with you or something. But we need to be a Jesus-centered discipleship factory where people are coming to know the Lord and growing as disciples and duplicating themselves and their friends and their family. I would love for us to have 100 baptisms this year and reach 1,000 people who are growing and want to see what God can do in their lives and in the lives of this church. But to accomplish these things, I need your help. Here's the first thing. Please try to make a commitment to be here consistently. I know it's hard, and I know we are busy people. And when I reach out to people I hadn't seen in a while, and I say, hey, I haven't seen you for a while, almost always the answer is, I'm very busy. But let me just be super transparent. I promise you I'm not trying to be snarky. But we devote an hour of time to far less important things than worshiping the creator of the universe. All the time. Please make a commitment to being consistent in worshiping. You need it, I need it, and we need each other. And this is a part of that growth. To develop a culture in your home where going to worship is the norm, not the, well, should we go today or not? Don't ask your kids if what they want to do, because half of them will go French toast, and that's the end. Kids don't get to decide if you should go to church or not. Lead your children and train them up in the way they ought to go. Because if you don't, they won't when they get older. And so if you're traveling, go somewhere, watch online. Make a commitment to be actively engaged in the lives of the people around you. Lead people to Christ. We'll teach you how. In the fall, we're going to have a workshop on how to lead your friends to Christ. I hope there are 1,000 people there who are that interested in the spiritual growth and the salvation of their friends. Because guess what? Salvation hangs in the balance for tens of thousands of people. Come to a connections class with me. Let me tell you the story of Renew. Become a consistent giver. This is one of the great challenges of a new church, that people don't think about giving until they get there, and it's whatever I got in my pocket. If I gave whatever I got in my pocket at any one time, the max amount would be about $1.32. I don't have cash. Now, we've created options for you in that, but here's the thing. Try not to look at church as a country club. We're not a country club. This is a living, breathing, moving, beautiful thing that God's created. And so that means that people think, well, I'll just pay my dues when I show up. That's the wrong thinking. But to invest in the ministry that God has called us to, and to do it consistently, even if you're not here, but think about it ahead of time, put it in your budget, pray about it, work toward tithing even. This is a spiritual thing, and we've talked about it here, or at least just giving consistently. New churches, typically you get about $15 per person per week is usually what you standardize. Like if you have a family of four, the average would be about $60 a week. Probably not anywhere near a tithe on that kind of thing, but that's about what a standard church plant, but a mature church or a church that's been around, established a long time, is probably $30 or $40 per person. So there's a big difference in $60 a week and, you know, $160 kind of thing. But this is an area that we grow in, and Renew has grown in this area. But I want to encourage you, because here's the thing. It would be wonderful to pay off this building. I hate it that we have to have debt for anything. Although I will tell you, it's not very much compared to what kind of infrastructure we have. But it would be great to pay off this building, add a couple staff. We probably could hire 3 people right now. But we don't have the ability to do that. But we need that as we grow. But also to plant more churches and feed the hungry and buy car parts for people that need their car repaired, that are stuck in a cycle of poverty that will not get out unless we train them and teach them and help them and heal them and lead them to Christ. It does take finances to do it. Yes, simple things like electricity bills that at the lowest amount ever that I've seen was actually last month. Not sure why. It was $900 just for electricity. But as we triple size, that will be different. And so even simple things like that, to be able to do the things that we're called to. But continue to grow spiritually, continue to seek the Lord, seek his face, and do the things he's called us to do. And please make people feel welcome. Last thing on that is this. Please try to come early. We joke about it a lot about here. You know, our attendance can shift. This is not an exaggeration. Our attendance can shift 200 people from the first song to the third song. Now, I love you. This is a family meeting, so here we are. Please try, because you're hurting yourself by missing out on an opportunity to worship. But also, there are people here that need you to say hello to them, and they want to say hello to you. And coming early allows you to build a relationship, allows you to be still and settled, so when you walk in this room, your heart's ready to worship, and you don't miss anything. I don't want you to miss out. I want that for you. And so try to be here early so that you can experience all that God has in mind for you. The last season's this, transition. Are we in a season of transition? The answer is, of course we are. And this summer, we'll probably lose 100 people because we live in a military town. We'll probably move out 100 people. We do every summer. But we'll probably have 200 more come. And when we build out, we could have 400 or 500 more come. And we've lost some folks for other reasons, like people that said, I'm going to take the summer off, and they never come back. Yes, I have had people tell me, hey, I love Renew, but I'm going to take the summer off. Okay, I'll never see you again, but okay, bye. You know, it's that kind of thing, because that's just the reality. Or people, when they go through crisis, they leave. This is the perfect place to be when your life's broken. You need to be here so we can love you and support you. Or people that have said, you know, my feelings have gotten hurt. Well, guess what? When people hurt your feelings, the Bible says, forgive them. It doesn't mean you got to run away or any of that stuff. I've had people leave here because they said your building's ugly. And I'm not sure if I should be offended or proud of that. I don't. Because the building's a building. And yeah, it's an old warehouse, a distribution center. In fact, it's what you're sitting in. I like that personally, a distribution center of God's blessings. As we are poured into here, you take it where you go. And you share the love of God with the world around you. But we're a mission station. We're not a museum. There's some churches that are nice museums, very pretty. But we're a mission station. It's who God has called us to be. And so it is what it is. But here's the thing. The build out for us will probably be the greatest transition. But we're also going to work hard to reach Valonia and BB. And again, this time of transition change, it can help us, it can make us get off balance a little bit, but I don't want you to be. Change is hard. Know this, you are loved and you are where you're supposed to be. And we work on this together and we grow together, but work toward not allowing the devil to sidetrack us and get us disunified. We need unity as we move forward in order to reach thousands for Christ and to grow and mature. This is what we're called to. And we work together to do this thing. So I say to you, my friends, let's fight the good fight and let's major in the major things. Like Ephesians 4:5, there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. let's pull on the same side of the rope. And if you feel out of balance or nervous or angry or frustrated, just talk to me. And we'll figure out why and we'll work on it together because I love you. Or talk to one of our shepherds. This is part of what they're there for. They love you and we are family. But don't allow division to get a foothold ever. Instead, Colossians 3, 12 through 15 says, put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other. As the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body. And be thankful. If we could really love each other, we could do anything that God calls us to. We have to love each other and to grow in that. And so why are we doing all this? Well, I love you. We love you. You are loved. And I want the absolute best for your family and for your friends. We want you in heaven. And I want everyone you know in heaven. I can't reach them as good as you can. But I want your children in heaven and your neighbors in heaven and your coworkers in heaven. And God has designed this church to accomplish that no other thing on earth can accomplish. But he calls his church to this time and to this season. And he invites us into something that's truly life-changing. And I want that for you. And I want it for your marriages. I want it for your kids and everybody. And believe me, it would be way easier to do none of these things. It would be so much easier just to create a Sunday morning show and then go home. It would be so much easier. Say, we'll see you next week. Plenty of churches do that. And I suppose if I were just trying to barely sneak you into heaven, that might be what we would do. But here's the thing. What I really want is to get a little piece of heaven into you now, that you can experience the joy of your salvation now, and that it's contagious to the world around you. This is what I want. I don't want to make your life busier. That's not the goal. I want to make your life and mine more joyful, more meaningful, fulfilled, and fruitful. And so where do we go from here? What do we do with this? Well, we have a lot to celebrate. God has done amazing things in this place. And God will do even more amazing things as we're surrendered to him and ask him to lead us in the way we ought to go. And part of that is, once again, to storm the gates of hell, to reach those who are perishing. Spread the good news. If you're freaking out, call me. We'll work on it together. And if you're excited, share it. Tell somebody about it. Tell the world what God is up to and how he's changed you and what he's doing in this city. But you are a gift from God, and I thank him for you. And so here's all I ask. Make a commitment to be all in for the Lord. And no matter what season you're in, let him bring it to the fullness. If you're in a dark, broken, hurting season, God can heal it. But let's do it together, okay? And if you're a season of joy and excitement, share it with somebody that's broken and hurting. Allow your light to shine like a light set on a hill. Shine that light, because that is contagious to a broken and dark world that desperately needs some hope. Church, this is part of our mission. As you go from this place to be a light in a very dark world. But today, come pray with me if you want to pray. If you want to make a commitment to follow Christ, let's talk about it. But come together and let's worship and celebrate the Creator of the universe who has called us to this time and this season. And let's do what he's called us to do. It's going to be an amazing adventure. And I'm thankful you're a part of it. So let's worship, let's pray, and let's seek the Lord's face for just a moment. And we'll come back together and finish up.
God, I look to you, and you're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom, you know just what to do. God, I look to you, and I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you, and you're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom, you know just what to do. And I will love you, Lord, my strength. And I will love you, Lord, my shield. And I will love you, Lord, my rock. Forever, all my days, I will love God.
Father, I pray that we will grow to love you more and more every day, and that love will be contagious to one another and to the city around us. Help us to grow in that love now, in Jesus' name, amen. You can have a seat. We're going to finish up with just a couple of quick things. We're going to take up an offering. I said a few things about it today already, so not much more that needs to be said. I'm just going to pray over the offering, and they're going to come through and do that, and then we have a couple quick things to celebrate, and we'll get you out the door. So, Father, thank you for giving us the ability to take up this offering. I pray that it is worship for us, that we will begin to look forward to this moment and prepare ahead of time, and that it's something that we grow in our own hearts to trust you with. But I also pray that you'll help us to have everything we need to accomplish the things you've called us to. Help us to be good stewards of it all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, well, we've got a couple things to share. So a couple celebrations. I really told you about most of those already. We had like 6 baptisms this week, 4 within our youth ministry, which was super exciting. And then our automotive ministry kicked off yesterday and got to serve some people through that. And that was super exciting. And again, part of all of that is as we are able to financially provide, we can take care of some of those needs. And we'll have more to talk about that automotive ministry as we go forward and some ways that we're going to do it. Okay.
It's always fun because things like that, people go, why are you doing this for me? And then you get to explain, well, I'm doing this because I love Jesus and Jesus loves you. And then it starts a whole conversation.
That's right.
So this is why we do what we do.
Yeah.
Like you said, because we want to see people in heaven. And we have to open those doors and get people in to be able to talk to them.
That's
so
right.
I love it.
That's good.
It's really good. Okay. So I don't know. Is that all we were celebrating?
Yeah, for now. How about that?
Okay.
For now. We have lots of things to celebrate.
It seemed like a lot.
Yeah.
Okay, so what were my announcements? I'm hiding something behind me.
I've got a couple things. Okay. So VBS is about to start.
Woo!
It's right on our heels.
Yeah!
We have a slide for it. We need you to get your kiddo signed up for that today. But sign up your neighbors and your neighbors' friends, your coworkers, kids, and all that. We want to launch this. Please don't wait till the 3rd because it makes it very hard for us to plan. And so please get the kids signed up. We also have summer camp coming up and all that stuff. If you want to help with a scholarship to help pay for a kid to go to camp, we would love for you to do that. But, you know, there's all kinds of ways to get involved. And make sure you get a bulletin before you leave today. And there's all kinds of things, including like a women's conference coming up in September and all sorts of neat things. But make sure you get this and take a peek.
And VBS is no charge.
VBS is free. It's just camp.
If you want a t-shirt for your kiddo, it's 10 bucks. And
right.
It's on the form when you sign up. But VBS is no charge. And it's an amazing time to bring your babies. And if you want to volunteer, we can always use the help, too. So.
Yep.
Vacation Bible School.
That's right.
Everybody knows it. Okay, so if you ordered a t-shirt, and it's not here, it's because it came in Friday at like 3:30, and I was in Branson. Yeah, so I didn't
Good
get your t-shirt. But I will have them Monday, so I can either call you, and you can come up here and meet me during the week, and I'll give you your t-shirt. And if you haven't paid, I can collect then. Or I'll have them here next Sunday. So it's totally up to you when you want your t-shirt over the next week. Also, last weekend was Mother's Day, so we have some great pictures of the ladies here because we celebrated all the women here. And if you, when you go out the door, if you see a picture of you, please take that picture of you along with you because I'm not comfortable with throwing people's faces away.
Right, yeah.
So I don't really know how to do this better. So I need you to please pick up your faces.
I know a couple stalkers that live, and we could just hand them to them, and then I'm just playing. It's okay. Get your own picture.
Get your picture.
I'll throw them away. And you don't have to.
You did that before, and I couldn't throw it away. Okay, so then we also have a new life group or a new community group starting up. I'm really excited about this. This is something that has been talked about for years, I feel like. But we have a single moms community group that has started. So Jana Coleman will be in the back, along with all the other community groups that are stationed around the back. If you're interested in getting involved in a life group, community group, or affinity group, take a look at what the signs say and see if that's something that interests you. But Jana will be in the back for the first time today to take people who are interested in the single moms group, and then we'll get you more information about that. But that is a celebration that we actually get to start that group. I'm very excited. Okay, and then there's one more thing. I got new yard signs.
Yes.
I'm really excited about these. Okay, so we have not had yard signs for quite a while, and we've ordered new yard signs. So, like, this one says military welcome and bikers welcome and serve and love. There's others that say single parents welcome, that say church wounded welcome, skeptics welcome, tattoos welcome. So we make sure we have them. There's three different ones, and they're combined. Next week, they will be available for you to pick up and put. We have the stakes and put them in your yard. And this is a cool way to invite people to church that drive by and you never actually get to talk to. So next week, they'll be available for you to pick up in the lobby.
Awesome. Okay. Last thing. Oh, thank
you. Thanks, Bob.
Good job. So a couple things. One, I want to apologize for going a little long today. There's a lot to talk about with this, and I thought about breaking it up into two things, but it's hard to do with holidays and things coming up. So I apologize for that. If you want to punch me in the face, I'll be right here afterwards. You can do that, okay? So I love you. I'm thankful for you. Let me say one last prayer and get you out the door. So, Father, thank you for giving us today. Thank you for the work that you've done in this place, and we're thankful for what you're about to do. Help us to be excited and go out of this place and show the world what you look like. We praise you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Love you much. See ya. Bye.